Some demonstrations are so ubiquitous and fit into so many different contexts that no matter how carefully you plan across the department, there is the risk that some students might have seen them before. For that kind of demo, I like to have a few extensions up my sleeve to really take the concept and flip it on its head, or perhaps even on its side. When we increase the temperature of a fluid, its density decreases because the vibrations of the particles become more energetic, leading to them taking up, on average, more volume. As we saw in the last issue, this is commonly shown by dropping a crystal of potassium manganate 7 into a large beaker of still water and heating from below. A couple of decades ago, at least in the UK, it seems as if there was a shift in the size of the crystals that were being supplied for potassium manganate 7. That impacts exactly what kind of response you are likely to get to the cannon fire demonstration, for example, link below, and the old school approach to dropping in a single large crystal with some forceps. Technicians suggested that they got better results using 1 to 2 centimeter ball of plasticine rolled up, and then using this to pick up a few of the smaller crystals commonly supplied these days, and then dropping the whole thing into the beaker of water. But what if you've seen that already? That's when it's nice to have some extensions on hand. I freeze up some ice cubes of 0.02 molar manganate 7, and because water is so strange in the way that its solid is less dense than its liquid, the cubes, of course, float on the surface. Here we see the opposite effect, with the ice cooling the fluid around it, causing the density to rise and the liquid to sink to the base. The convection current in reverse. So, convection could start upwards or downwards, but is there a way to initiate a sideways motion? Well, if we remember that our particles are attracting one another, then yes. I have here a Petri dish with some coffee liqueur in it, Tia Maria, although of course other brands are available. For our purposes, the things that we need are the dark color and the sugar and the alcohol. In theory, you could make up a model yourself. The sugar in the drink ensures that the net density of the liquid remains high enough that if you carefully drop little blobs of cream onto the surface, and I'm using 36% fat cream here, they will float. Notice how I'm keeping the spout close to the surface of the liquid. I've got my beaker only slightly filled so that I can get the cream really close to the surface to keep these little rafts of cream around. Keep adding blob by blob until you have about 80 to 90% coverage, and you'll notice that at the edge of the rafts of cream, the white surface pulls away, sideways. This is due to the third component of the liqueur, the alcohol, which has weaker forces between its particles than the cream does. This is easily shown by placing a droplet of cream and a droplet of ethanol next to one another on a white tile. The forces pulling particles together in the cream are greater than those in the alcohol. Of course, once liquid at the surface moves sideways, other liquid must be drawn up from below, away from where the cream is. This is further helped by the low density of ethanol adding to its buoyancy. Soon, the circular motion is easily seen, perhaps with the assistance of a visualizer, in the tumbling of rolls of cream caught in the rapid convection. Beautiful patterns can appear as these convection cells coalesce or fall apart where the local concentration gradients conspire. Thicker layers of cream often lead to single, stable cells, while thinner layers behave much more erratically. It's a beautiful and simple demonstration to have on hand, and I've never found anyone who sees it for the first time who isn't amazed. So give it a try and let us know how you get on.